Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Awards Watch Emmy podcast. I'm your host, Eric Anderson. I've got with me today Emmy expert Chris Pepper. Hello, Chris.
Hello.
So this is our first Emmy podcast of this 2016-2017 season. It's Monday, March 27th, and we are going to focus solely on the limited series TV movie categories, because just the Emmys just have way too much, and these podcasts could last 7 hours long, for better or for worse. So we're gonna hit through the acting categories and the top category, and here we go. Let's get on our way. Let's start with supporting actress in a limited series or TV movie. This is has the potential to look a lot like the top actress category here, where it's completely just jammed with Feud and Big Little Lies. And outside of that, it kind of could go anywhere. What are you looking at right now, Chris, as your predicted six here?
What do I have? I have Kathy Bates for American Horror Story, Judy Davis for Feud, Laura Dern for Big Little Lies, Sarah Paulson for American Horror Story, Shailene Woodley for Big Little Lies, and Catherine Zeta-Jones for Feud.
Mine's pretty similar to yours. I actually have Helen Hunt in for Shots Fired over Sarah Paulson. But We're kind of at a stage right now where there's not a lot of announced or solidified category placements, and this category included, which could have, it could see Shailene Woodley being pushed lead. I hope she's not, because she'll be able to get in here. And then we've got Regina King for American Crime, who's won this category for the last 2 years. But maybe she's put in lead like Lily Taylor was last year. It's tough to say at the moment, and we'll have more information in a month or two, but this is, I guess, kind of where we are right now. I feel really, really solid about Judy Davis, Laura Dern, I actually feel really good about Kathy Bates, and I know some of us have Ellen Burstyn for custody in, and it's one of those things where you can never count out Ellen Burstyn at the Emmys. So
yeah,
but neither of us have her.
No, does anyone from the Emmy experts have her?
We're the only ones that don't. Interestingly enough, we're the only ones that have Kathy Bates, but Fred and Jonathan and Nicole all have Ellen Burstyn. So we'll see who triumphs there. Ha ha ha.
Well, if Ellen Burstyn happens there, then lead actress, which we'll talk about later, is probably going to get even more messy, because I can't imagine Viola Davis then doesn't go into the conversation as well. I know that sometimes Burstyn just gets name-checked, but
not always, because that's something that we've done before and kind of gotten ourselves in trouble. But that's one of the things that's really different about the Emmys that makes it quite a different animal to predict than the Oscars. There isn't this, lead up with tons of precursors and critics awards and all of these things that start helping, help us shape the race and see who real contenders are. And the Oscars and SAG and Golden Globe also go off of a calendar year, and the Emmys have their Emmy calendar, which is, September to May 31st. So it's a really, really different animal. We have the Globes and the SAGs from this year to go off of a little bit, but anytime you have something like a mid-season show, like we have a dozen or more, like 20 shows, and some that haven't even started yet, you know, so you can't look to SAG and the Globes as for a whole lot of things. Some things you can, but it's messy. I kind of wish the Emmys would just give up the ghost of the extremely dated September to May television season, because that just is not the case anymore. It's television is year round. There is no more all reruns in the summer. This isn't the 80s. It just doesn't happen. So
yeah,
they might do better changing their format at some point, but that's, I guess, neither here nor there now. Go ahead. I'm talking way too much right now.
Yeah, I was just going to say about Burston, like, I think everyone assumed almost that she might win for House of Cards last year, and that didn't happen because, oh wait, did Margot Martindale win last year?
Yep.
Again? Oh no. Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. So if we do a drama like a podcast, 2 minutes that might be something to talk about, but
yeah,
and it seems weird that none of us have, I don't think, do any of us have American Crime ladies in supporting actress?
Yeah.
A couple have Regina King in.
Yeah, Fred does. Yeah, so it really makes sense. Yeah, Fred and Jonathan do.
Yeah, I think Gold Derby have her in lead at the moment. They've switched her and Lily Taylor the other way around this year. So it's a complete question mark at the moment what's going to happen with that. And then you've got Sandra Oh as well, who would make sense. So
yeah, Sandra Oh would make more sense here. I mean, the show's only 3 episodes in. But I don't. Yeah, I know these predictions are going to see a whole lot of change.
Yeah,
in the coming months. I mentioned just before we started the call that I know we all have Catherine Zeta-Jones in, but we're getting toward the end of the run of Feud. Bette and Joan, and Zeta's had very, very little to do. And I'm just, I don't know. It would seem like an easy snub as much as it would seem like, oh, well, it's Catherine Zeta-Jones, so sure, she'll be in.
Yeah, and this category could get really competitive really quickly, like Mary Elizabeth Winstead for Fargo. I realized I didn't have her listed. She seems like she might have quite a substantial role, judging on based purely on the trailer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely the most substantial female supporting role.
Yeah. And then you've got the Big Little Lies ladies, Feud, American Horror Story. I think Paulson and Bates were the only ones to hold on to a nomination from that show last year.
Yeah, the hotel was a pretty disastrous season for that show, which has done, like, you know, 17 nominations every year. It does so well. And last year was pretty bad. But it was also a really bad season.
Yeah. And I think we've seen the Emmys move away as well from just awarding people for their name rather than just a 5-minute cameo as well. So
yeah, it just, that's what worries me, though, about having Sarah Paulson, because she just won. She was double nominated last year. She's had 6 nominations. I mean, they really do love her. And she's really, really hilarious in Roanoke. So I can absolutely see her getting in. But the Emmys can be really weird. They either stick with people forever and shows, or you get dropped and then you get dropped.
Yeah.
So I wonder if Horror Story is kind of done, especially with Feud being, you know, 1, on the air, and 2, super popular.
Mm. But then American Crime Story was popular last year, and American Horror Story still kept hold of its nominations, so
yeah, it's, I don't know. Maybe there'll be some Ryan Murphy fatigue.
That is very possible, but
I don't see it, though. Certainly not with Feud.
Yeah,
I anticipate Feud will be the with probably The Crown, the most nominated shows come July. That's my bet.
Yeah. We haven't even mentioned the two HBO movies either. So you've got... I didn't even realize Kristen Connolly is in The Wizard of Lies, so that's probably a supporting performance to look out for. And then Henrietta Lacks, you've got Rose Byrne.
Hey, don't you dare. Don't you dare.
Rose Byrne, and I think there's another fairly substantial part in that as well.
There is, and I'm wondering how that's gonna go, because that's a lot of HBO.
Yep.
Especially
with, I'd say Dan's almost a lock at this point.
And yeah, it's Renee Elise Goldsberry.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
Goodness, but that looks like kind of all that we're dealing with are those names right now.
Yeah.
There's not a lot that might break through. Adina Porter from Roanoke might. She's really, really, really good.
So it'll be interesting what HBO actually prioritized, because I could see Woodley sort of getting lost in the shuffle, but at the same time, it's a fairly substantial supporting role, and she's really quite good in it.
Sorry, AW. I mean, you know, yeah, my dislike for her is pretty huge, but I absolutely love her in this. So I love her. I think she's great. Yeah, I think both HBO and FX have a lot to consider with these categories, because and how they're going to promote and who and it's really ironic, because you know we just had the episode of Feud last night that ends with the Oscar nominations for that year. And. And how much Joan Crawford was bitching that Jack Warner wasn't promoting her as much as Bette Davis. And then, of course, Bette Davis is the one that ended up with the Oscar nomination. So, I mean, it would be hilarious and crazy, you know, for some kind of weird random thing like that to happen. And we'll get to that when we get to the top category, too, because there could be some juicy, juicy snubs there.
Oh, my God.
Oh, I love it. I love it. All right, let's jump over to supporting actor in a limited series. And I'm looking at our lists and kind of, again, a lot of similarity. And I think that's just going to be the case at this point until we...
Yeah, we start. I think there's just a lot of question marks at the moment.
It is. So there isn't a whole lot of reason to break free from what seem like some pretty safe choices.
Yeah.
I have like Hank Azaria for Wizard of Lies. He is a huge Emmy magnet. He just won last year. Richard Cabral for American Crime, who's been nominated here before. Martin Freeman Sherlock, who's been nominated here. Alfred Molina for Feud. Michael Stuhlbarg for Fargo. And Stanley Tucci for Feud. And I think I have the same,
yeah. So again, they all make a lot of sense, but then at the same time, there's probably another 10 contenders which could all feasibly be quite strong as well.
Yeah, just looking at, there's a little bit of difference with some of our predictions, but not very much at all. Looks like Fred has Adam Scott for Big Little Lies instead of Michael Stuhlbarg. I don't know how I feel about that.
Yeah.
I'm not so sure about that.
I actually think he's quite good, but it's just such a, not small role, but just such a quiet.
Yeah.
Fairly marginal. I don't see any of the actors actually happening from that show. I think it's just the four women.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't mind Alexander Skarsgård getting in, because he's pretty spectacular in it.
Mm.
But this category also has, like, Courtney B. Vance from Henrietta Lacks. It's got David Thewlis from Fargo. It has Idris Elba from Gorilla. Michael Kenneth Williams from The Night Of.
Yep. Who got nominated last year, I think.
Yes. And of course, Courtney B. Vance is a winner last year.
Yep. Yep.
So I'm when I see this and I see sort of the same names, I have to feel like there's no way that we're, you know, this locked in this early. Yeah. And I wonder if something like Sherlock is almost on its way out, and then I think, oh no, they just won last year, and I'm like, well, no,
just won. There was a point during the ceremony where we thought Sherlock might actually win TV movie, I think.
Yeah.
Because it was winning everything.
it was bizarre. And it's just the way of the Emmys are, it just makes it so hard to predict so many times.
Yeah. Sorry, it wasn't last year, was it? It was the year of the Normal Heart.
Yeah.
I don't think it was eligible last year.
I'm sure. Yeah, I'm not. Now I need to find the last thing that it won. Because I think
Martin Freeman won.
Yes.
The last time he was eligible. Yeah.
Lord. See? That, I mean, it's like, how? Why? Where did. How?
Did Hobbs win as well? Yeah, they both won.
Yeah. Yeah, 2016. TV movie, special effects. It just won. Jesus fucking Christ. And it was 2014 that.
Yep.
Cumberbatch and Freeman won. Boy, that was a lot. Jeez, that's a lot of wins. Okay. But yeah, I mean, it just won last year. So you're like, okay, maybe it will get in. But Freeman didn't.
So it was Freeman missed last year.
Freeman missed last year. Oh my goodness.
I didn't think it was eligible last year. Okay. If he missed, like... Oh boy!
I know, and it's so funny too because he was on Fargo, and so that
yeah.
Boy, I want to take him out like right now.
Because Cumberbatch still made it, and it's still one TV movie, and Freeman.
That's so disgusting.
That's right. Yeah.
Ooh. I think I'm going to take him out. I gotta think about that.
You know he's just going to pop up if you do that, though.
It's only March 27th. I can do what I want. So you said you have not watched Feud yet, correct?
No, I need to start. I will start tonight, probably.
So last night's episode had a large portion of it veer from Crawford and Davis and focus on Alfred Molina's character. So it would, even though limited series contenders don't have to submit episodes, it would be a good episode for him because he has a good amount of screen time.
Yeah.
And Tucci, too. It's a lot of back and forth between those two. Of just like them worrying about the success of the film before it's released, and then of course, as history knows, the film was a massive success. But so I mean, I have no doubt of Molina getting in here. I think that's an easy call. Tucci may be a little bit less, but I mean, the Emmys have already showed that when they love a Ryan Murphy show, they love the shit out of it.
Yep. Yeah, I feel good about both of them making it in just based on their name and how much I expect them to love the show, really. Like, they both seem like easy nominations. And the same with Azaria. And then it's all just a bit of a clusterfuck after that, really. I think.
I mean, it's weird. I feel great about Tucci, Molina, Stuhlbarg, because Fargo also does really, really well.
Yeah.
Azaria, just his Emmy history is too strong. And then, so I'm just looking at Freeman and Cabral, both, you know, previous nominee and a winner, and go, okay, how is this category not locked up already? But then like we mentioned, you've got Courtney B. Vance, and you have other people that are absolutely potentials here.
Yeah. And Fargo has a history of getting like more than one nomination in the category as well. So you could see Stuhlbarg and Fulis get in here quite easily, because they both look like they have quite showy roles as well.
Definitely. And as we saw with that last season of Fargo, it wasn't, you know, Ted Danson that everybody predicted getting in. It was Bokeem Woodbine. Yeah. And that it was the lesser known non, you know, Emmy friendlies.
Yeah, it was the ones that were actually deserving, which is why I think, going back to the Zeta-Jones discussion, like, the roles seems a lot more important now. Like, you can't just be a name anymore. Like, you have to have the role to back it up as well.
I think so, too. I agree, and I think taking out Zeta-Jones would make a lot of sense. So yeah. I'm sure by the end of this podcast, my predictions will look different than what they look like today.
Yeah. But we don't really know what to make of the night of. Like, I think it could just be a case of it getting series director writer and then it's two leads. Like, I'm not sure it's strong enough to get the supporting actors in here as well.
That's where I'm at as well.
Yeah. Because Bill Camp was really good, I thought, but I don't think he has a shot.
He was wonderful. And yeah. I would love to see that. I would love to see that nomination. Oh, God. Now I'm really... maybe I'll put him in.
Yeah, because at the same time, I think I have the night of winning at the moment. Like, I think that's the one that... Oh, limited series. I just can't nail down who I think is going to win it. And I think the night of's got the combination of HBO and the acclaim that I think could...
Wow.
Push it above Feud, I think.
Oh, goodness. That seems very risky to me.
I'm not sure. Like, I think it's a real... I could make a case for all five of them winning. Like, Fargo Unseen could be just another absolute critical monster. I think Big Little Lies is the one I'm fairly certain might not actually win. It seems like more of an acting play, but...
It does seem more, like an acting thing. But I mean, what if the night of is like Show Me a Hero, though?
Yeah, it could be. But I think it's more in the Emmy wheelhouse. It's crime drama. It had a bit more buzz as well, I think.
Yeah, I agree. I think it did as well. But I'm, you know, that's always going to be something I'm thinking about. That I don't know.
So you think Feud's winning?
Right now, I do, yeah.
Mm.
Just at the moment, but I would love... I could also see American Crime winning, because it's very likely that this will be its last season. The ratings are just so unbelievably, like, shockingly bad.
Yeah.
It's so sad, because the show is so good.
Yeah, and that'll probably hurt it in the end. Like, the ratings are brutal. And I'm not... Has a show that's been cancelled ever won a series category?
Well, I don't think it would be cancelled. Oh, God, yeah. It would be cancelled by that time, yeah.
Yeah.
Oy. Oh, that's tough.
Yeah.
Hmm. I still think it has a great chance. The topicality of it is going to speak really strongly in the middle of this political administration in the United States.
Yeah, it's a great race. Like, there's no American Crime Story this year. Like, there are five legitimate all-could-win contenders almost.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, my goodness. Let's jump over to lead actor then.
Okay.
Because I think we do finally have some differences here. We do, it looks like. Who do you have, Chris?
I've got Riz Ahmed for The Night Of, Benedict Cumberbatch for Sherlock, Robert De Niro for The Wizard of Lies, Idris Elba for Gorilla, Ewan McGregor for Fargo, and John Turturro for The Night Of.
Okay. Yes, we do have some differences. I have Riz Ahmed. I have Benedict Cumberbatch. I have Benito Martinez for American Crime. Robert De Niro, Wizard of Lies. Jeffrey Rush, Genius. And John Turturro, The Night Of.
So what is Genius?
It's an Albert Einstein movie.
Oh my god.
Oh yeah, have you not seen like the really crazy little trailer for it? It's on National Geographic, but like I don't even care. they got like that Bible epic in. Remember? Wasn't it you?
Yeah, I do.
Or no, it was Peter.
It wasn't me that had it, yeah.
That's right, it was Peter that was like, it's getting in!
Oh, God.
And, I mean, I have Rush in, essentially, over Ewan McGregor, which, you know, I don't know, it's pretty risky. Patrick Wilson missed out for his season, and he was the lead. But I know Ewan McGregor has dual roles in this.
Have you seen the trailer?
Yes.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
I really can't see Ewan McGregor missing for this. Like, it just looks like pure bait almost.
Well, this is a scenario in which I could see actually then Robert De Niro the one that misses out. I can see The Wizard of Lies, even though it's HBO, just being a total non-starter.
Yeah.
Poor Michelle Pfeiffer. This is supposed to be her year. Yeah. But, I mean, you know, obviously I'm sitting here with Benito Martinez in my predictions, and the only one that has that, so... Why wouldn't that be the first person I take out? Because I think American Crime is still going to do very well. That's why. But Idris Elba.
It would be amazing.
It would. Sometimes I have to be the one that has the only, you know, sole prediction out. Either to highlight it or to, you know, so that I can brag about it later. Usually I just make an ass of myself with it, but, you know, sometimes I can do it. It seems really tough to bet against Idris Elba. He does really well here with the Emmys.
I'm intrigued by that show in general. Like, it's a BBC drama, which, you know, there's always... I said it last year with, not last year, but with Wolf Hall. Like, they always get a British production in here.
True.
And it's also the combination with Showtime. They seem really confident in it. It's airing in April prime Emmy season, so it's definitely one to watch out for. It's got a political message as well, so...
It does. Oh my god, it has Frida Pinto. Oh.
What was the British show that happened in limited series last year? I've got a complete blank. Of course, The Night Manager. Absolutely, like...
Oh, God. the number one show in the South Sudan. Ugh, fuck Tom Hiddleston. Oh, my God.
Yep.
Oh, that's right. Jeez. They really do love their British shit.
They love their British shit.
No offense, Chris. Oh my goodness, that's right.
Yikes. And they love Idris Elba as well. So that's I think Gold Derby have him listed in supporting. So it's not, I literally know very, very little about the project, but
and that's like we said, category placements are still so up in the air. So much of this could change just depending on that. And so we just have to go off of what we kind of think might be the case right now.
Yeah.
I don't know. I feel really good about Jeffrey Rush, though. I feel good about Turturro and Ahmed. I would be saddened if only one of them made it in, because they're both so good.
I don't know which one would make it over the other, though. It'd just be a really weird snub that couldn't really be explained, I think.
If it was going to be just one over the other. I think Turturro would make it in over Rizema, but he's really more the lead than Turturro, so
maybe I don't think one will go in supporting, but
I don't think so.
They couldn't justify it, I don't think.
It's just funny that, I mean, the series starts with Rizmed and it ends with Turturro.
Yeah.
And it really becomes a little bit more about Turturro by the end. But Rizmed makes a massive transformation character-wise from the beginning. So it seems really difficult to not...
Yeah, if I was going to rank them, I'd have them 1 and 2 at the moment. Like, I feel like they're in the project that's been seen, and they're both really good. And I think the show is going to perform fine, so I don't see why either would miss at the moment.
Yeah, I have to agree, and I don't want to either.
Yeah, yeah, and then I have McGregor in third. I would say I think.
Yeah, maybe I'll just go out and just. Say, fuck you, Robert De Niro. You're not making it in. Oh, my God. I'm over at Gold Derby. Like, they all have him at number one. There's, like, 3 of the 5 have him at number one, De Niro. And then the other 2 have him at number 2.
Yeah.
What is wrong with people? Yeah. Oh, God, that's right. Michael Gambon, Churchill's Secret. Yeah. That's a really good pick. Oh. This is stressful.
They have Alfred Molina in lead as well.
Yeah, Marcus does. That's weird. There should not be a male lead of that show.
Mm.
But I could see him cheated into there.
Like, if with McGregor, like, if there's one place I think Fargo could pick up a win, he would be the first name, I think, without having seen it. But that's where I'm leaning at the moment. Like, I really think he has a shot at winning for it.
I guess I need to put him in. God damn it. I'm gonna put him in over De Niro, and you can all suck God. It. Yes, I'm doing it right now. I just did it. So it will update at some point, and oh my God. And I'll be a laughing stock. Whatever. It's March. Oh my goodness. Well, I guess we should get to... I don't know, maybe we should skip actress and go right to, like, limited series and TV movie. Actually, let's go to TV movie, because I think that'll either be I think that's going to be kind of a quick one. Oh my God, look at me with my standalone prediction again.
Yeah, I think you are.
Yeah, everybody has, I'll just read them off because everybody has the same thing. Custody, The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks, Killing Reagan, Sherlock, and The Wizard of Lies. And I have Churchill's Secret in place of Custody. Because it's still Lifetime. I don't care if it's Viola Davis and Ellen Burstyn, it's still a Lifetime movie.
Yeah.
And they've given some acting nominations before, but they're not like... They still don't really take the network that seriously.
Yeah, I mean, those are the 6, aren't they? Like, I think you put The Wizard of Lies, Sherlock, and Henrietta Lacks as the top 3, and then I think 2 of the other 3 is probably what makes sense.
Yeah, I'll be really hard-pressed to see anything outside of this 6 make it in. There just isn't that much. I mean, I'm glad that they again, broke up the categories, you know, between TV, movie, and mini. Even though there's just not that much.
It's just turned into a HBO category, though, so...
Yeah. Ooh, look at Gold Derby. All Churchill's Secret everywhere? That's great. Looking the movie, Daniel! Come on! Daniel!
Oh, does one have Looking?
Yes!
No.
Girl, come on. I gotta talk to you about that. That's not happening. Dark Angel. I don't even know what that is. My goodness.
Yeah. Killing Reagan. Like, they love those sort of shows. It's on National Geographic.
Yep, that's another Nat Geo.
Yep. So...
Hmm.
Custody hasn't aired yet, has it?
No, I don't think so.
What channel is it on?
It's Lifetime.
Okay, right. Yeah.
So no.
And yeah.
Genius starts in a month. but that's a limited series, not a not a TV movie.
Yeah. Oh my god, this category is brutal.
Oh my god. Oh jeez. Viola Davis is a judge in custody.
Yeah.
She's on the other side of the gavel. Hayden Panettiere. Oh my god. I hope she gets nominated over Ellen Burstyn. That would be amazing. I want that to happen right now.
Oh, this is going to be terrible.
Oh, it did already air.
What?
Yeah, March 4th.
Oh, wow.
I'll have to watch that on demand, I guess. Oi.
March. I don't think I've seen a single review for it.
No, I had not seen really anything. Oh my goodness.
Like, even for Lifetime standards, no one has paid attention to that.
Oh, that's weird. It's from James Lapine from... Oh my god, how crazy. Maybe I need to give this another glance. Yep, I guess that'll be added to my on-demand viewing now. I mean, I try and watch everything anyway, just to... To have a better picture of things, but I didn't want to have to watch that shit.
You got 4 stars from The Guardian, okay.
Yeah, but The Guardian, you guys have some really sketchy critics there, so yeah.
That is literally the only review I can find.
I'm not going to touch that. So, that, I mean, what does it give us? That gives us 2 HBOs, BBC, Lifetime, PBS, and Nat Geo is kind of what we're looking at right now. That makes sense. That's pretty traditional Emmy fodder.
Yeah.
So I don't really see much else past that getting in.
No.
Well, we all have the same exact predictions for limited series, too. God.
I think it's just, yeah.
And it's not even fatigue, it's just that it's like, yeah, no, it's just consensus. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. It would be a massive shock if any of those 5 missed, and then if something, I don't know what would replace it. I guess, like, Black Mirror's, like, lurking is something that's doing quite well in the industry at the moment, and it's got a lot more buzz now that it's on Netflix. It got the SAG nominations.
Yep. There is somebody from Gold Derby that is predicting Black Mirror. Everybody else has the same consensus top 5 that we do, except for Matt Noble, and he's predicting Black Mirror to get in over Big Little Lies.
Wow.
Yeah.
Just cannot see that happening.
No, that's so weird.
I mean, the one vulnerable, I don't even think it's vulnerable, but American Crime, I guess, because of the ratings, but it's literally having one of the best reviewed shows of this year. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that counts.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I do think there is potential for Black Mirror to spoil, but this 5 is just so tight.
Yeah.
There's not that much room.
It's just a solid 5, I think. But then people really love Black Mirror and people are catching up with it on Netflix. And, you know, it's a new season that Netflix have put out themselves now. So people are taking notice, and it got a lot of actors attached to it as well.
Yeah, it's impressive that it has the attention that it has right now, almost based really on like one episode.
Yeah. They'd almost be better off submitting it as a TV movie, because outside of that one episode, it's really not been a great season.
I think that would be exactly what they should do.
But then it wasn't the episode. Who was it that got SAG nominated? Because it wasn't from
Bryce
that
Dallas
episode.
Howard.
Yeah, that's right.
That didn't make any sense.
Oh my god.
Ugh.
The problem with this as well is they can't submit any of them in guests. So,
nope.
I don't think they're going to get any acting nominations. I'm just going to leave it as a sixth choice. I think.
Yeah.
Maybe he'll get like a random writing nomination. I think that would make sense.
I mean, yeah. I don't think that I will change my five here.
No.
For the entire run of predicting all the way through July 14th. I don't see. Because Fargo's going to come in, it's going to have great ratings, and it's going to have great reviews. There's no way it's not making it in. And like we said, it's actually really difficult to find the vulnerable show here. American Crime
The Night of might win, but it's the show that aired a long time ago, and it might just have lost some buzz. But again, it's a really critically acclaimed show on HBO that had quite a lot of buzz at the time. Even if a lot of it was about Turturro's feet, but...
and the cat. I wanted to win just for the last 5 seconds of the series. I screamed. I screamed on the couch and just, like, burst into tears. Oh, my God. It was so... I was just... I can't even recall like ever doing that with something on television, certainly not recently. It was just such a great moment. I loved that show. All right, well,
What's the
that?
Only other one was Gorilla, but we've mentioned that already, but
yes.
we'll see what comes of that, I guess.
And Genius.
Yeah, okay,
but shut up. Oh my god, why are you so down on it? But we have Killing Reagan there.
Yeah. I guess Gilmore Girls is dead, isn't it?
Well, I don't even know why we would even mention that.
Okay. We'll move on then.
Yeah, because that's... Yeah. And,
is definitely dead.
That's definitely not happening. That's super definitely not happening. So appropriately enough, we will close out with... what is inevitably going to be the most hotly contested category of the Emmys, I think, this year. And that is limited series or TV movie actress. We have so many Oscar winners and nominees in this category in contention. I have never seen anything like it, and I blame Glenn Close for the state of the limited series Emmy race now, because when she couldn't win an Oscar and nobody would hire her, she came to television and started with The Shield and then Damages, and she set the pace for women being able to find really, really, really great material on television. So, I mean, I tease Glenn Close, but she really did. She was who opened this path.
Yeah.
So, good for her. And now we have the likes of Reese Witherspoon, Susan Sarandon, Jessica Lange, Nicole Kidman, and Michelle Pfeiffer,
holy
and Felicity
shit.
Huffman.
Oprah, don't forget Oprah.
I was just, I'm getting to that. That's how big this list is. There's also Oprah, who's an Emmy winner and an Oscar nominee, but not a primetime Emmy nominee, and Carrie Coon. And she's going to have Fargo and The Leftovers airing at exactly the same time, which is kind of great for her, because The Leftovers isn't doing shit Emmy-wise. But anyone that watches... you know, a good amount of television you know, we'll be able to see her in both things at the same time and feel like, wow, she's got
yeah
a lot it of got range.
It got the Game of Thrones slot. Like, I'm a little bit more hopeful. Final season, like, I'm holding out some weird hope that The Leftovers just gets a random bit of Emmy love. But
that would be so strange.
It would be strange, yeah. But it's in that buzzy Emmy slot with the two Emmy comedies, so it's going to definitely have a bit more attention on it, I think.
Yeah, but, I mean, HBO has two other shows.
Yeah.
They don't need to do anything with The Leftovers.
Yeah.
But that's for a different podcast.
Yeah. I can't believe we started the actress discussion talking about The Leftovers.
I'm glad. The Leftovers is like the best show on TV, and I wish everybody had watched it. And well, you know, if you want to take a look at the predictions as you're listening to this podcast, you'll see that I am once again on the outside of the group. Everybody has Carrie Coon in, and I have Felicity Huffman for American Crime in instead. But it looks like none of us have Oprah. Nope.
Yeah, Oprah snub.
Jonathan has Huffman too, but wait, who's he snubbing?
I have Huffman. I think we all have.
Oh, we do. Wait.
No, we don't all have Huffman. No. I think we've all got a slightly different combination.
It is a little bit different. Good. Yeah, I'm trying to like look at who's missing. I'm like Big Little Lies twice, Feud twice. All right, American Crime, Fargo. There we go. Man, that is. Anyway, okay. So this is, like I said, is going to be easily the most contested and the most competitive category. There are going to be real, real snubs. And then I'll get to use the defined snub gift from Susan Sarandon when that episode airs next week. And I did float the idea around on the Awards Daily TV podcast that Susan Sarandon could potentially be snubbed here. And
I would die.
We would all know why. It would be glorious. It would be so fucking meta for her to be snubbed here and for Lang to get in.
It would be my favorite Emmy moment in a long time, I think.
Me too, very, very much. And I almost want to predict it.
Almost. Oh my god.
I mean,
I can't go there yet.
Oh no, I won't. I don't think I would anyway. But I want to so bad. It would be really impressive. But
we have what looks like four locks here, and there are like five different shows that haven't even aired yet.
Yeah. It's
like we feel good about the two actresses from Big Little Lies and Feud at the moment, but what if like Fargo, Wizard of Lies, and Henrietta Lacks are all, like, really good?
Well, I think, can't they push that with the new voting rules, it could end up being seven, or is that just with the series categories?
I think that's just series.
I think it is just series, so that rule doesn't go into effect here.
Yep.
Hmm. That'd be even better if they could have seven here and Sarandon still got snubbed. Oh, my Lord. So you have been watching Big Little Lies, correct?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
What are your thoughts on Witherspoon versus Kidman?
I think at the moment I'm predicting Nicole Kidman to win.
I am too.
I said it on the forum, but I just think she's never won an Emmy before. She's been nominated, but she's never won one. It's a big HBO project. We just said it's like more of an acting showcase than for the series itself. It's not only, she's not only great in it, it might be like career best work. And it's a hugely baity and powerful performance. I think there's a lot in Kidman's favor for actually winning.
I do too. I'm already a Kidman fan, but week after week, and the way that they're telling this story is so intelligent and relatable. And I think it would be really easy to take something like physical abuse and sexual anger and have it sort of feel like a somebody else's problem kind of thing. And they also are doing a really good job of taking, you know, a bunch of rich white ladies mm-hmm. and giving them these issues that don't, that are still incredibly, make them sympathetic and make you empathetic for them. They're not trivial issues that they're dealing with. It's not the Real Housewives of Monterey.
Yeah.
Which it could have dangerously veered to.
Yeah.
Or even like Desperate Housewives, and it's nothing like that.
Yeah, it could have easily been Desperate Housewives, but... And if you'd have just shown me the first episode, I would have said, like, I would have thought Witherspoon had the better role and had the better chance of winning after the first episode, but...
Everybody thought that.
I think the fourth episode just sealed it, really, with the therapist scene. It might have been the fifth episode.
The third was the really, really great one when she's there with Skarsgård, but the next episode when she went by herself...
Yeah, the one when she's by herself, I think.
...was just like, all right, here we go. This is...
Yeah.
This is, like, Emmy-winning work. Yeah. And this is a case where I really wish there were submission-based...
Well, there are, but...
You don't have to, though.
Yeah.
Like, Sarah Paulson didn't last year. She sent the whole thing instead of an episode, right? I think, yeah.
I think she submitted Marsha.
All right, somebody did. I'm blanking then. Well, I hope that's what she submits. If that's what happens.
That's sort of what I thought after seeing it. Like, if the submissions matter, then this is when we'll see that it matters, because that is like a perfect submission.
It is. And we've seen
the Emmys like love therapist scenes as well. Mm-hmm. Like someone acting and just breaking down emotionally in front of a therapist, like they win Emmys all the time by doing that.
I think it's because everybody in Hollywood is in therapy. They're like, I can relate to that. Oh my god, I'm rich and I have problems. See, like what I did, I just totally reduced it to something that it's not. No, I agree. I think I feel like unless they just have Lang fever like they've had, this should be Kidman's to lose. Witherspoon last night though was so good.
Yeah.
So good. I think the thing that kind of has happened with her is that, not that she's been comedic, but she's had a lot of lighter, slightly funnier material than Kidman has had. But like her admission to her daughter last night was, oh god, it was such a great scene.
Yeah.
That would be like submission worthy right there.
Yeah. I think it's just a very easy nomination. Like I'm not sure she can compete with Lang and Kidman in terms of winning.
I think so.
So too. I think she'll be happy to be nominated almost.
Yeah, and I think interestingly enough, the same issue sort of befalls Sarandon versus Lang, in that Lang has had the more dramatic, sympathetic material. And Sarandon has had a little bit of it, but certainly the more over-the-top and outrageous and funnier stuff.
Yeah. And yeah, I think it's definitely Lang v. Kidman.
I do too.
And I'm not sure even if like Carrie Coon's absolutely incredible. Like, I don't think I see anyone else emerging really.
Yeah, I don't either. When Alison Tolman was able to lose against Kathy Bates, I was like, okay, they like Fargo, but they don't like it.
Yeah.
Because that should have been an easy win.
But it wasn't. Yeah. And Lang's won 3 times before, so I'm not sure if that helps or hurts her, especially when she's going to be going up against Kidman, who's never won before. But the combination of how loud and baity the role is, plus how dramatic it is, like, they might just really love Feud, and if they love Feud, then Lang might easily just win.
Oh my god, Feud's gonna get, it's probably gonna get, like, almost 20 nominations, you know that.
Yeah.
It's gonna have everything, from the title music to title design, it's gonna have everything down the line.
Yeah.
I wouldn't even put out Jackie Hoffman or Allison Wright, especially after last night's episode, as supporting contenders. I'm not even kidding. They could go absolutely apeshit over this show. I'm just going to say.
You mentioned the Murphy fatigue. Like, is there any potential for that? Like, is there almost a risk of voters seeing this as almost too trashy in a way?
But it's not trashy, and that's the thing that has saved it, and I think will save it from being Murphy fatigue. It's not...
Right.
It isn't as campy as everybody thought it was going to be.
Yeah.
It shocked everybody by how sympathetic and grounded it is. It has obviously great flights of fancy that are just going to be organic because of the situation.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not played to the nosebleed seats. A little bit in moments. I mean, I know you haven't seen it, but Lang has some particularly hilarious Crawfordy moments. She has one in last night's episode that is pulled right out of Mommy Dearest. I mean, right out of it, even to the outfit. And then just this gorgeous, "Not you, bitch!" to Sarandon, which is now like my favorite gif of all time. So, I mean, there are moments that are campy, but it is not like what I think most of us thought it was going to be. So I feel like the Emmys are going to be very, very friendly to it.
Yeah, I was going to save it for a binge, but I might just catch up now.
It's a good binge. It would be a really good binge.
Yeah, I imagine it would be. Oh, boy. I can't get over either how Feud Season 2 is going to be called Feud Charles and Diana. Like, that's too tacky for me. Like, see, I can't.
This is the thing that might be the thing that is the fatigue or just is maybe a bridge too far. So they better just get what they can right now, because when you've got Charles and Diana and Versace down the road coming, it's just like, I don't know. But
I'm quite excited for the Versace, but
I am too. I'm not totally happy with the casting. I had much more interesting casting in mind for that, but oh well. I don't know. They could both be fantastic. You know, Katrina's coming too, so.
Yeah, I don't even have a problem with Ryan Murphy doing a Charles and Diana series, but calling it Feud, like, oh my god.
Yeah, I wish maybe it was something else and not.
Yeah, it didn't need to be
in the Feud universe.
Yeah, it didn't need to be.
It's not
part of that.
It's not the Feud that I don't know. It's just I don't know. It's that was really unexpected. And boy, there's going to be scrutiny over that casting to an astonishing degree.
Yeah. What did you think of the Penelope Cruz casting? Like, I thought that was perfect.
I thought it was genius.
Yeah.
because Lady Gaga wasn't going to do it, and Gina Gershon already did it.
Yeah.
So I thought it was absolutely genius. And I'm super excited for that.
Oh, God. Next year's Emmys are going to be so messy. I think American Crime, they're airing them both, like, within the same Emmy season, I think. Like, we're going to have Katrina and Versace next year, I think.
I thought they weren't going to be in the same season.
Because they're filming them all at the same time, I know that.
Yeah, but I thought they were doing it like Survivor, and one was getting filmed first, but airing later.
Yeah, okay.
I thought, oh, now I'm totally getting it mixed up, so somebody will have to correct me, because I thought it was Katrina first, then Versace, but Versace is shooting first.
Okay.
I mean, if they're going to shoot Katrina, they're going to need to have some... They're going to have to shoot it at some point during the rainy, bad season there, which is not in the summer, it's going to be later. If they do location stuff, which they clearly are going to.
Yeah, and I assume Feud Season 2 is going to be next year as well.
Yeah, but I think that will probably fall outside of the purview of the 2017-2018 season.
Yeah, I've just read apparently Sarah Paulson is being linked with playing Princess Diana.
I know everybody said that like right off the bat because obviously Sarah Paulson will be in it somehow, and I'm like, no. No. I love Sarah Paulson, but
no.
She cannot play a 21-year-old Diana with her slightly, you know, baby chubby face and the whole no. I'm not going to accept that. So,
yeah.
I will take to social media to demand it not happen.
We haven't even talked about who we think's going to miss here yet.
Well, I mean, I did.
Okay.
I think Sarandon could absolutely miss.
Yeah, but you have Kuhn missing at the moment.
I do have Kuhn missing, yes. Which means both leads... No, I did just put Ewan McGregor in, but I did have both leads of Fargo.
Yeah. Out. I think if one of the leads does miss, like Patrick Wilson, it would be Kuhn over McGregor.
It makes a little bit more sense, yeah. This is a category like that just, is too stuffed.
Just the twins thing I can't get past. Like, it seems like a winning role.
It does. It makes a lot of sense now.
Yeah. Then at the same time, like looking at the trailer, it almost seems like Kuhn's the lead, and then McGregor's almost playing two supporting parts.
Yes, and I guess that equals a lead. So, but yeah. Carrie Kuhn is definitely... looks like the lead, but in a Frances McDormand Fargo plea kind of way, which is almost supporting.
Yeah. So I have Kuhn getting in, and I have Pfeiffer missing at the moment.
And I can see that. And Pfeiffer is actually somebody that could potentially be a supporting role.
Yeah. Yeah.
We haven't seen very much of it, and we won't really know until May, really.
That would make sense.
I could see Pfeiffer being bumped down. But then if she is, does that mean that it's easier for Kuhn, or is it easier for Oprah? Or is it easier for Viola Davis, since you brought her up?
Oh my God.
You brought her up, so now we have to talk about her.
I think someone from Gold Derby is predicting.
I think
Viola.
So.
Yeah, it's got one prediction.
Yep.
One's predicting Bryce Dallas Howard as well.
That too. I'm like, okay. And then Regina King
is part of the consensus six there. Wow.
I know.
This is an absolute mess.
Yeah, the only person that's not predicting King is Matt Noble, who was predicting Viola Davis instead.
Wow.
Oh boy, this is a mess. Oh my God, they... all have Lang at number one, except for Chris Beach. Oh my gosh. Kidman at number four. At number five? What is wrong with you people? Number six. Chris Beach. Oh, uh-uh. Michelle Pfeiffer over Nicole Kidman. Are you kidding me? No, ma'am.
Lang's role might be too big to lose, but Kidman is pretty clearly at least second, in my opinion.
Matt Noble is not predicting Kidman. Oh, words are going to be exchanged. Words. I don't even know what to deal with that. Nope, I just don't. Yeah, I mean, oh my God, if Regina King gets in here. Wait a minute. So is Felicity Huffman on their list? Because I don't
seventh.
See her.
In seventh.
Wow.
She's got one prediction.
Oh my.
So basically we're looking at Lang, Sarandon, Witherspoon, Kidman, King, Kuhn, Huffman, Pfeiffer, Winfrey.
Mm-hmm.
Ugh.
There will be snubs, I'm telling you.
I think I just want to root for Witherspoon, Kidman, Lang, Sarandon, Oprah, and Pfeiffer. Like, I just need to see that category, I think.
That would be the Oscariest category that the Emmys have ever seen.
I think that's a close second to just wanting a Sarandon snub. Like, those are the...
It is. I'm almost with you on that. I want to see it. I want to see that grouping or like a Sarandon snub. Oh, that would be rich. Rich.
Yeah.
Well, I think this is a good place to close. Although, as I've said, we could probably talk about lead actress for a 2-hour podcast, but there will be more down the line as we get closer to those Emmy nominations. But they're all the way in July, which seems like forever, but it's really not that far. It's 3 months. So I think we are good for today. Chris, thank you so much for joining me on this Thanks. Podcast.
It's okay.
And where can people find and follow you on Twitter?
I can be followed on Twitter at cpepper95, and I'm on the forums as well. So
excellent. And Awards Watch is at awards_watch on Twitter. And you can like us on Facebook and follow us on Instagram and all of those lovely things. And jump into the forums and talk about who you think is going to get predicted. And check out the Emmy Experts predictions. And they change and are updated daily. And we're going to be doing more podcasts in the very near future, tackling each section, because there are just too many damn categories at the Emmys to do all at once. So, again, thank you, Chris, for joining me, and thanks, everyone, for listening. ¶¶